Hi everybody, Stephan Kesting from GrappleArts.com. Today, I've got my good friend Elliot Baev, and we're going to be doing an interview both for the Grapple Arts Radio podcast and for my YouTube channel, just picking your brain a bit about the evolution of Jiu-Jitsu and how to build game plans that work in competition or in training. Now, I obviously know you, and I know you to be a really high-level competitor. You've won the Abu Dhabi Pro Trials, you've medaled at the Mundials, you've medaled at the Pan Ams. You're competing all the time, and you run a very successful school in Toronto, Open Mat, and you're also a really good teacher. All these things I know, but the people watching or listening might not know that. So why don't you take us a little bit through your history, Elliot, and, Jiu-Jitsu.
Good. Jiu-Jitsu with Elliot Baev.
Yeah.
I started Jiu-Jitsu back probably in 95 or 96. A good friend of mine had gone down to train with the Gracies after the first UFC. And
were they still in the garage at that point?
No. They had their school in Torrance, and it was really eye-opening when he came back. And smallest of all of our friends, he was, when we would play fight, he was beating everyone up. And I had trained in Taekwondo and Kung Fu, and I bought into that whole, Bruce Lee movie magic that we all thought back in the 90s about martial arts, and I was sure that my kung fu training was gonna outbest him and allow me to outdo him, and it was just a whole, for everyone who kind of got exposed to jiu-jitsu in that time, it was just a wake-up call that something different was out there, something special was out there. And it actually took me a long time to even be willing to try it, like 6 months of him trying to convince me to give it a shot. And then it was actually...
You were like, don't cloud the issue with facts. Or don't
yeah.
cloud the issue
yeah,
with proof.
Exactly, right? Yeah. Well, you invest years of your life.
How many years had you done Taekwondo?
I did Taekwondo for about 5 years and then Kung Fu for 2. And, it's hard to let go of these ideas of what's real that you grew up on, especially when you're doing martial arts that aren't necessarily real. No knock against anyone who trains Taekwondo or Kung Fu, but certainly the place I was training at, it wasn't a live training, it wasn't hard sparring. I was a kid, so obviously it was a bit of a McDojo, but it was a real shock to the system to actually see the Gracie in Action DVDs or VHS tapes at the time, because there was no real, outside of the UFC, which I hadn't even seen after I had trained with him, there was no real example of actual fighting that you could view, so everything was based on theory. We all know the story, right? And then the Grace came along and woke everyone up. So
will your southern mantis defeat my northern long fist form?
Yeah, wow. Exactly, right? Yeah. Just a lot of nonsense in retrospect, but thank goodness for the wake up call, and here we are today. 15-20 years later. Black belts and having fallen in love with Jiu-Jitsu.
So in between getting your ass kicked by this smaller guy, and now, how did you who did you train with en route?
Back in high school, we took a trip down to California to train with the Gracies. Actually, we first went down to Philadelphia to train at Maxercise with Steve Maxwell and Phil Migley-Reese. They were both still purple belts. And then the next summer, down to California to train with the Gracies. And there were no real schools in Toronto, so we kind of created a bit of a training group. We found some other guys and just found community centers where we could put mats down. And it was very kind of hodgepodge, but learning through tapes and anytime, it was like a godsend when a purple belt would come into town or even a blue belt. And we would just... try to acquire knowledge, which was so hard to do at the time, and just try to train on a regular basis. And it was very hard training at the time. It wasn't necessarily the most technical.
But you're still laying down the foundations of rolling around with somebody and trying to get to the top and getting your basic biomechanics down. You can come a very long way, especially, with tapes back in the day and with videos, DVDs, YouTube, apps now.
For sure, but those first few years it was tough to grow your knowledge set outside of the tapes you had. So it was a good journey, but definitely a slower, longer one than people have access to today. You know, there's so much information available. So for the first, from 97 or 98 up until 2001, maybe, it was just, or maybe 2000, it was just training community centers. And then a few of the guys that I was training with started their own school. I went over to train with them. That was, again, for a few years. And then eventually they split up. And so I'd kind of been without an instructor for a little while, and then was down in LA for a wedding. Trained at a bunch of schools. You know, I used to train with Eddie Bravo quite a bit, John Machado, and then went to Sean Williams' school and was just blown away. The level of detail, the technique, the kind of refinement in the technique reminded me of that feeling that I had back when he started Jiu-Jitsu, and it was like, wow, there's this magic here. It really works. And so over the years, just trained more and more with him and eventually became affiliated under him. So last 6-7 years I've been under him. Mm-hmm.
Well, I get, you know, there's funny because there are different teachers and they all have students. So clearly they must all, you know, have a good student to teacher match. But it, you just find somebody who matches you personality wise and technique wise. And,
yeah.
And, you know, maybe their method of teaching matches your method of learning.
Yeah, there are all sorts of different aspects to the instruction. Like one thing I really loved about Eddie Bravo's stuff when I first learned it was just how systematic it was. Mm-hmm. And as a fighter, as a competitor, you know, that basically what he does really well is he's built a game plan. Right. He's built a very thorough, effective game plan, you know, with a lot of unorthodox names, but that just helps people remember. But for me, in my position, you know, I was running a school and wanted to offer my students a kind of complete picture of jiu-jitsu. And when I came across Sean, you know, he's a great wrestler, great with judo, super articulate, and good not only on the offensive side, but amazing defense, and just a very, what felt to me like perfect understanding of the game. So for me, that's kind of being a teacher and wanting to give my students the complete jiu-jitsu. That for me was definitely something that appealed. So, you know, everyone has something valuable. Some guys are amazing competitors and can teach what they do, but maybe you don't necessarily want to have a competition style. That might not be the person for you, right? Mm-hmm. It is important. It's a very personalized thing, so you have to find the school that makes you happy. So, yeah.
Well, it's not only the teacher, but it's also the students and the training environment. I think that's, in some ways, even more important than the teacher. You could have the best teacher in the world, but if everyone at the school's an asshole,
yeah.
You're not going to enjoy training.
Totally. Totally.
If you don't get along, here, I'll make it more general. If you don't get along with the other people and you like spending time with them and you don't think that they have your best interests in mind, they're not driving you in the way that you need to be driven, you're better off changing schools, even if the teacher's not as good, if the training environment is better. Yeah. I say go for the better training environment.
I think so. And training environment, not just in terms of, you know, who has the most killers, because, you know, jiu-jitsu is a very personal art. It can get kind of, you know, it sounds maybe a little funny, but it's an emotional art. Like if you don't have good relationships with the people you're training with, it can just be stressful. It can cause anxiety and it can make you not want to be there. And if you don't want to be there, you're either not going to go, which you're not going to get good if you don't go, or you're going to go and you're not going to be focused. You're going to be stressed out and having all these, mm-hmm. you know, little political relationships to worry about. And it's not worth it. And that's been very kind of fundamental to the type of, that's fundamental to the type of school I wanted to have.
Mm-hmm. Well, why don't you talk a little bit about your school? Because we talked about your beginning and a little bit about your middle, but where are we now? Where are we now?
So I have, I'll take it back from when I started my school. So back in about 2003, 2004, I was competing down in the States and I was working full time in the corporate world. I was doing some corporate sales and I just kind of, there were some things going on for me personally in terms of kind of what I wanted to do with my life, but I just fell so in love with jiu-jitsu and the idea of, you know, helping marketers sell more makeup when people were suffering in the world, and giving my time to that rather than doing this thing that was so good for you, so healthy, so positive. It was hard to keep going back into the office for me. And so I basically, as soon as I figured out how to do it, I quit my job, cashed in my life savings, and started my first school, which was actually a women-only school. You know, I didn't want to, it's always been very important to me to use martial arts to do good. And, you know, anyone who does jiu-jitsu knows how valuable it can be for women, you know, deals with intimate situations, works for a bigger person. For me, it's just a very obvious conversation.
Yes.
And so I also didn't want to compete with the schools I was training at. So I started a women's school because, especially at the time, as I'm sure you experienced, you know, you'd go into train and there'd be guys in little bad boy shorts, yeah. spandex shorts with no shirts on, super sweaty. And it wasn't always a comfortable environment for guys, let alone girls. This was, again, before The Ultimate Fighter was popular, before the UFC was popular. So jiu-jitsu wasn't a household name. So to walk into a place and see that, definitely a little uncomfortable. So I started this women's school to try to create an environment where women would feel comfortable getting into jiu-jitsu because, again, we know how valuable it'd be for them. Ran that for 4 or 5 years. You know, it had its ups and downs. Financially, it was a tough business to build. You know, it was very rewarding, but it was, you know, to run a, even today with UFC and jiu-jitsu so popular, I think it'd be hard to run a women-only school. But back then, it was definitely difficult. And in about, I think 2008, I just kept getting calls from people who'd heard of me through competitions and whatnot, oral training partners who wanted me to, you know, wanted to come out and train with me. But I was only teaching women, so I started Open Mat out of Kimono Girl was the name of the women's school. So we started Open Mat, and very quickly that kind of overtook it. But what was interesting is because Kimono Girl was designed to be this very warm, welcoming environment, and that was the foundation of Open Mat, Open Mat just adopted that same atmosphere and that same vibe. And today it's, you know, we've got hundreds of students. We were in like fitness gyms renting space. Now we've got a big, beautiful space with a skylight, windows on three sides, like so much. You've been there. Yeah. Lots of natural light.
Right in the heart of downtown Toronto.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's kind of a, like, literally a dream come true for me. It was something I'd wanted for years. And not only is the space beautiful, but the atmosphere, everyone who walks in, first thing they say is, wow, everyone's so nice here. And for me, you know, if you want to be a world champion and that matters most to you, then you have to find the school that's going to help you get there. For me, if you don't feel comfortable being in an environment that where people aren't necessarily super nice to you, then again, it's going to be hard to become a world champion in a place like that, even if there are killers on the mats. You know, we actually took a student from never had any training to white belt world champion, but, you know, that level nonetheless. And we have a number of high level competitors, but for me, that's all secondary. I personally don't care as much about that as I do that the, you know, 40-year-old urban professional who maybe has been out of sports for a while, that he comes in or she comes in and feels totally at home. That for me is top priority. Because how much beauty is there in jiu-jitsu? What a mind-blowingly wonderful, beautiful art. And for me, it's about, can we share it with everyone? You know, how much more confident are you, am I, or, you know, everyone who does jiu-jitsu from having trained in it? What if we could give that to everyone?
Sure. Well, it's not only the techniques, it's also the dealing with adversity,
of course,
and the emotional resilience mm-hmm. that you build, and mm-hmm. probably in the long run, for sure, in the long run, that has a bigger effect on your life mm-hmm. than the actual techniques per se.
Absolutely. And that for me, that's why I want to spread it. Like, it's, you know, hopefully no one ever has to use jiu-jitsu on a practical level. We never have to use, ideally we never have to defend ourselves, mm-hmm. but you know, the confidence you get, the self-assurance, the emotional fortitude, as you said, is invaluable at home, in the boardroom, you know, in relationships, and then yeah, on the street, not necessarily in a fisticuffs sort of sense, but just in social situations as well. So I actually, one of my students moved out here a month or two ago, and we had dinner last night. I was talking to her about how jiu-jitsu's changed her. And, you know, she and her husband came in 3-4 years ago, and they were just, she was such a wallflower, you know, super, super nice, super shy. And now she's just a monster on the mats, an amazing purple belt, great wrestling, an incredible guard. And all that is secondary because, you know, she's gained a whole new level of confidence. Someone who wasn't comfortable with public speaking, now she's, you know, she was teaching for us for quite a bit before she moved out here. She said, you know, there's no way she would have had the confidence to take this, you know, to make this big change in her life, to pursue her career, moving cities. You know, she's never done anything like this. So maybe a dozen times I've had people tell me that this or the school has changed their lives. And for me, that's the most rewarding thing we can get out of martial arts, you know, that it's really elevated someone's entire life. Because again, you know, if ever anyone has to defend themselves, you know, we have had those situations, and thankfully people have had the tools to do that. But for the most part, at least in Canada or in Toronto, or at least the circles that my students are in, for the most part, we're able to avoid violence. So what's the value of jiu-jitsu if it's only a physical art? And it, again, you know, it's changed my life for sure, you know.
Well, we're talking about students and teaching. And one of the things I really like about your teaching, which brings us sort of the next topic, is the sense of the big picture. You're not just teaching a technique and then, hey, here's another completely unconnected technique, and hey, here's, you know, tomorrow we'll do another third technique that I downloaded off the internet. Mm-hmm. You're really good at putting together game plans and coherent systems for teaching an aspect of jiu-jitsu. So how would you define the term game plan? Maybe it's a little bit different from how I define it, but we better get this straight before we delve too heavily into game plan.
Sure.
We just got to agree on what it is.
For me, when I think of a game plan, like to step back, when you talk about trying to teach a kind of complete picture, that comes very much from how I am as a student. I want to understand. And so when I'm teaching, I try to give an understanding, and I don't think you can really understand a technique in isolation. When I start talking about a game plan, for me, that does get very narrow, and it does get very specific, because, say, in a competition context, what you're trying to do is know exactly what you want to have happen in the fight. Of course, fights are messy, and things happen that go outside of you, what would ideally happen. But for me, you know, setting an intention of knowing in a perfect world what would a fight look like, that's fundamental. That, you know, when I made the shift in competing, I was probably like after my 30th or 40th competition match, I started making the shift from worrying about what the other person was doing to seeing exactly what I wanted to have happen. You know, that highlight reel of awesome moves of me just kicking butt. That's when there started to be a real shift in the results. And that the next level of that was not just to, you know, be visualizing great moves, but to say, okay, exactly start to finish, what would I like to have happen?
Well, let's give a concrete example. You're competing end of the month. I promise not to release this before the end of the month. So what's your game plan going into the gi competition? What's your game plan for 3 weeks from now?
Well, since we just worked on a spider guard project, I want to, you know, I do like to work the stand up a little more, but I'd like to, hopefully it goes well and I didn't just screw myself, but I'd like to have some spider guard to show. I'm probably going to use the langi drop, try to pull guard that way, or pull close guard depending on what I feel is more appropriate. And then, just keep relentless on the attacks. Specifically the stomping triangle and balloon sweep, sit down sweep, as a combo from Del Hiva are really valuable are really effective for me. If it ends up in a situation where we both have grips, one thing I'd actually like to show, maybe we can put it on a YouTube thing, I don't think we included in the project, is so everyone knows who watches a lot of competition, the fake guard pull to single leg.
Right.
One of the challenges that you have with the regular guard pull is as you try to pull, the person can pass right away. So I actually use the fake guard pull to single leg as a fake for my guard pull. So if we end up in that situation, I'll probably do that in order to start pressuring for a balloon sweep. And because we're going collar sleeve on that balloon sweep, that ends up, person often wants to post, and I've had some success with the balloon sweep armbar in the past, so going to aim for that. And really just, for me, of course, I want to win the competition, get the title, but I want to have fun, and I want to, for this project, it's a good exercise to try to get spider guard actually working in competition. I've been focused on other things. I've been just at a no-gi competition. I haven't competed since last year except for that. So
well, you've also got the close guard is one of your other go-to positions.
Yeah, exactly. So to bring it back, so either pull and play spider or close guard, and then it's my basic game, which is ideally getting that arm across, getting the lat, pendulum sweep. I've got a move I came up with a few years ago. If we're having trouble getting the pendulum sweep, I was able to pull it off at the no-gi pans a few times. So just really everything for me is kind of about build. A game plan is almost an algorithm that once you put the person in a perfect game plan, once you put the person in the algorithm, it doesn't matter what they do, where they go, they're going to end up, output with a submission, right?
Is that because there's an answer to every response that they give you?
Yeah, I'd say an intermediate advanced level game plan, absolutely. A basic level game plan is, for example, giving a simple example, okay, pull guard, balloon sweep, mount. Well, that's not the end. How are you going to finish them? Okay, double collar choke, right? Or palm up, palm down. That's the skeleton of a game plan.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next level would be, okay, say that all goes perfectly, I get to the mount, and I'm trying for the choke, but they defend. Okay, slide up, S mount, armbar. So you want to have kind of a robust picture of what it looks like at the end, but then you work backwards. Okay, I pull guard, and I go to sweep them, but I'm not able to get the balloon sweep. They lean a little too much to my left. Okay, I'm going to go sit down sweep. Come up, and now I'm in their guard. I cut across, get to side, get to mount, and then we're back in the end of that algorithm, right?
So you've detoured for a little bit and come back to
exactly
your main skeleton of a plan. Yeah,
and I've got a little tool. 2010 Abu Dhabi Pro Trials, I came up with a way to write out your game plan, because you don't want. For me, it's very important that you're very proactive and offensive, and that you're not thinking about things going poorly, but at the same time, you have to address them. For example, I didn't want anyone to pull guard on me. I wanted to either take them down or pull guard myself. But I had to be ready, because a lot of people, especially at the time, were pulling half guard, and so I wanted to be ready for that. And I remember the first match I had at that tournament, the person pulled half guard, and I don't know if there's footage of it still, but I was just smiling to myself because things were going exactly as I had envisioned. And what it allows you to do, this way that I'd come up with, you basically, on the left side of your page, you map out, in a perfect world, what does the game plan look like. Then beside, at any stage in that game plan, you draw a line, and you say, okay, what if the alternate happens? So I get my grip and I take them down. Okay. And then that follows a certain path. Draw a line, alternate reality. At that stage, after I got the grip, they pull half guard. What am I doing here? And it allows you to prepare for contingencies without worrying, so to speak, about what the person does. So I don't know if that's a great explanation, but the idea for me is you want to be very focused on what you want to have happen and not necessarily too worried about the other person, but at the same time, you have to be ready for where things can go.
So now, you're a black belt. You've been doing this for 20 years.
18, yeah.
Okay, close enough. We'll add you two years of kung fu. Because I'm sure there were hidden grappling applications.
That I didn't even pick up.
Yeah, but you were learning them at a deep intrinsic level. So what you're talking about isn't specific to one position. No, not the spider guard or a certain style of guard passing. If you were a butterfly guard player, you could have a game plan. Totally. If you were a top player, you could have a game plan. Your teacher may or may not be able to convey this to you. So let's go with somebody who's learning techniques one at a time, worst case scenario. Here's a choke from the mount. Here's a way to get to the back. Here's an escape from side. How then do they go and take all this knowledge that they're learning and plug it into such a game plan? What's the process of putting it together?
So assuming everyone understands what I think is the core strategy of jiu-jitsu, which is, you know, what do you do if you're facing a bigger, stronger, faster person who wants to beat you up? Mm-hmm. Close the gap, take them down, get to the mount. Mm-hmm. That's a game plan.
Sure.
Right? So whatever and that for me is the core game plan of all jiu-jitsu, and everything else we do, pulling guard, is just maybe an easier way to eventually get to the mount. Mm-hmm. Or if you don't want to go to the mount, you want to go straight to the back. That you're just kind of skipping steps. But ultimately, it's the same. It's all built on that idea. So if you only have one technique, one thing that I suggest to my students is to write out every position you know, starting with just four basic, mount, side, guard, and back, and top and bottom, and then write out the techniques you know from there. You know, and then, of course, include stand-up in that. So if you have one takedown, say you've got a good single leg. Okay, so single leg, and I know how to pass the guard with only the stack pass. Okay, so single leg to stack pass. Even though those may not be the best fit, if those are all you have, great.
To start.
What do you know from side control? I know a key lock. Okay, great. That's your game plan. I know how to mount. Okay, great. Now your game plan includes single leg, stack pass, either key lock or mount, and then from mount, if you don't know anything, you got to learn something. And once you learn a technique, then, okay, arm triangle. Okay, that's your game plan. Single, stack, mount, and arm triangle. And as you learn more and more pieces, one really useful tool to help build this is just to develop a mind map. And I think it's really important that you do conceptually start from standing, whether it's for self-defense or for competition, or even just for regular training, because every match starts there. And so you want to be very clear with yourself about how things are going to go down. If you don't feel comfortable taking someone down, that's fine, but you have to know how and where you're going to pull to. So if you feel good jumping close guard on someone, great. If you don't have a takedown, that's your game. But if you don't feel comfortable doing that, you need some way to get the fight to the ground. Mm-hmm. And so kind of building with whatever you know, connecting the techniques you do know while at least building it on the foundation of the initial attacks, the takedown, mm-hmm. or the guard pull that you do know is, for me, how you're going to start building a complete game plan.
Well, it's funny when you're talking about the very basic strategy of jiu-jitsu, which is close the distance, take the guy down, get him out. It doesn't get much simpler than that. Mm-hmm. I used to train for a long time in Kajikembo. It's a real hardcore system of full contact without pads, Kempo karate. And talking to the founder, Adriano Imperato, and his basic strategy was similar but different. It was like, hurt the guy, take him down, finish him off. That was his. And again, a game plan beats no game plan almost every time. I've been to local tournaments where there are schools that I would say aren't really very good, but their students, especially their super junior students, do really well because they all do the same thing. They've all been coached. First, do this, then do that, then do this. Mm-hmm. So when they're going against white belt, other white belts who don't have a big picture, they have a bunch of isolated techniques because they start training 3 months ago and they've learned a cross choke from mount and an arm bar from guard and a stack pass. Mm-hmm. They don't have any way to hook it together. It's really neat to watch the power. See, you've got a guy who's been training for 3 months here and a guy who's been training for 3 months there. Just giving them that first do this, mm-hmm. then do that. I mean, there are limitations to that, obviously. And I don't know how much trouble they'd be in if the plan deviated from there, mm-hmm. given that they're new. But it's a very powerful concept. Having some idea of what to do is and how to hook it together is way better than having no idea.
I think it's really valuable. It's been effective for me. And it's not the only way. And some people, you know, just like to be in there and suss things out and go by feel, and that's fine. But yeah, it's been very valuable. And I know exactly what you're talking about, where if you give a beginner something very explicit but simple thing to do, 8 times out of 10, they're going to be able to apply that against another beginner who just knows a variety of things but doesn't necessarily have an explicit plan of how to apply it. And it goes back to fail to plan, you plan to fail.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, what's the strangest game plan you've watched a lot of competition. You've been in a lot of these big tournaments. What's the strangest game plan that you've ever seen?
I don't know. I think probably Imanari in MMA, like just jumping into guys kind of butt first, or even in Abu Dhabi, you know.
If the guy punches, leg lock. If the guy kicks, leg lock. If the guy doesn't kick, leg lock. If the guy doesn't punch, leg lock.
Or Jeff Glover, Donkey Guard.
Yes, you know. At his latest Metamoris appearance, that was maybe the strangest jiu-jitsu I've ever seen.
Yeah, a little bit of presenting there, but
I remember being blown away by Eduardo Tellis's turtle guard, little bit back in the day.
Yeah, certainly when you're seeing something unorthodox like Tellis just pulling turtle, it's a bit of a shock to the system. For me, you know, but look how effective he's been with mm-hmm. it. For me, there's no bad game plan except no game plan, sure. You know. Or trying to do something that you're not great at. So I've seen guys try flying arm bars when they've never trained them and get hurt. You know,
guys are not flexible trying rubber guard and blowing their knees out,
yeah. Maybe doing things that aren't really appropriate for you, like a smaller, well, not necessarily, not that small guys can't do throws, but small guy in an absolute division, you know, trying
to insisting on a top, a top game.
Well, no, I think you can definitely play top, but you know, some crazy throw that requires either amazing technique or a lot of power and just things that seem not as well thought out. But
okay. Well, one other thing I wanted to pick your brain about is this whole evolution of jiu-jitsu, because you know, we've been talking about this spider guard project for some time now, but there was a time when the spider guard was a sign of the end times in jiu-jitsu. You know, mm-hmm. Like, oh my God, this is never going to work on the street. This isn't the closed guard at all. I mean, I remember the revelation that it was when I learned that the guard wasn't just the closed guard. Mm-hmm. You could open your guard. Oh my God, you could actually open it and do stuff from there? Mm-hmm. And, you know, there was a time when the guard was basically the closed guard. Mm-hmm. There was a time when the half guard was not at all an offensive position. There was a time when the spider guard didn't exist. Mm-hmm. Which is not to say that some crazy judo guy in the 1920s wearing the little, you know, knee-high pajamas wasn't using some form of it. But in terms of taking it and really developing it and giving it a name, those positions didn't really exist. Mm-hmm. So what about this whole, well, two things, I guess. One, how do you keep your finger on the pulse of what's happening in the jiu-jitsu competitive scene, because the game's evolving at a tremendous
very
rate
quickly, yeah,
right? Like what's today's technique, because it's not the same as 2 months ago. Mm-hmm. And secondly, what about the combative elements of this? What about the core self-defense aspects of all this crazy modern jiu-jitsu?
So, I guess first, how I keep on. I feel like it's definitely a challenge for anyone to keep ahead of the game in such a quickly evolving sport. And, you know, I definitely rely on my students who are, you know, constantly watching tape or constantly watching footage of high-level competitors, bringing stuff into the gym. A few of my brown belts, you know, are real innovators and real kind of students of the game who have helped me a lot. Dan Davis and who I don't know if you know, but Ostap, who I think you know fairly well. He actually does an amazing weekly analysis of, you know, one small mm-hmm. part of a very fascinating part of a match. So he's very kind of, I think, ahead of the curve in terms of the evolution of the game. So that's very helpful to have people around you like that.
But every school has those hardcores who are busy working some job while secretly watching every last YouTube video.
I don't know if there are a lot of guys like him around, but yeah, every school's got guys who are just aficionados. We even have some white and blue belts who are, you know, devouring material and coming up with new stuff on their own. So for sure there is that kind of culture within every school of guys who are hungry for the new and innovative stuff. And so that's really helpful for me. I do try to watch, not even try, you know, I love watching jiu-jitsu as much as I can. And it's just tough with, you know, not only is there so much more, so many more competitions. And so even high level guys like Mendez brothers and Kyle Tara and, you know, Lucas Dupree and man, dozens and dozens and dozens of, you know, Keenan and Bushesha and Leandro Lowe, like just so many top tier, amazing, Rodolfo doing, you know, sometimes similar things, but such unique things on their own. And then you'll have sometimes unknown guys who are doing amazing things. But it's not like years ago. I feel like the guys who were at the top 5-6 years ago weren't necessarily competing every month, but now you'll see Mendez brothers jump into like a local tournament, you know, a local IBJJF, or go to Texas or something for an IBJJF there. And so there's because of the spread of the internet and there's so much video now, there's so much information out there. It's hard to keep on top of and see everything that people do. So different networks, ADCC posts some very cool things once in a while. You post some great stuff. That's one way to kind of keep on top of it. But it's very, for me, it's very tough to devour all that information. Sure. So definitely relying on other people.
Which takes us back to the importance of your peers and your training group.
Huge, yeah.
And not even just, as a teacher.
Absolutely.
The information doesn't just flow down from the top of the mountain.
For sure. The you know, the irony of my path is that I kind of, large part of why I did all this was just started my school was because I wanted to train full time. I think that maybe happened for a week in the last 10 years because, you know, running a school is a big endeavor itself. So one of my challenges is to spend enough time on the jiu-jitsu side of things and not just trying to keep everyone happy and keep the school running. So for sure, you know, as an instructor, you can learn from your students, and especially anyone who's busy versus, you know, there are now full-time jiu-jitsu guys in many schools, and we're lucky to have a lot of those guys. So yeah, tapping into the people you have access to is huge. In terms of the whole, you know, effectiveness and self-defense, I think it's like kind of an argument with Mendez brothers versus what Hickson's trying to do with the Jiu-Jitsu Global Federation.
Sure. So upside down spinning Jiu-Jitsu versus a little bit more straight ahead.
So I read an article or an interview with, I think, Guillermo Mendez recently about this discussion. And one thing he said is that, you know, only bullies really worry about fighting, and that through the practice of the sport and the art of jiu-jitsu, you learn so much about yourself and you grow as a person so much. And that really resonates with me. I totally, absolutely. If you have no interest in fighting, but you do love the art and the spectacle and the kind of magic of jiu-jitsu, you can get so many of the personal benefits through that, through the sport of it. I am totally on board. At the same time, I learned jiu-jitsu at a time when it was the days of the Gracie Challenge and the early days of the UFC. And I really believe there is a value in training and learning the self-defense aspects, because even if, I'm a peaceable person, I've never had to use jiu-jitsu to defend myself, because I've always avoided those types of situations. And I believe for the most part, we can, different people live in different cultures, which are more violent, but I think if you work at it, you can lower the number of times you'd have to use this to defend yourself. At the same time, if I ever had to, I would want to feel ready. And I think there is value for the other side as well. I think there is value for the personal development, not in going around, like part of the reason I don't train knife fighting and what I do if that person has a gun is not because I wouldn't be interested in learning that stuff. I think it's kind of, it creates a psychosis. I think it's not healthy for your psyche to be thinking about, okay, this person really has a gun, not just for the physical side of things, but there's a lot of mental and emotional training that goes into that, that I think can be maybe damaging to you. So to let the self-defense side devour you too much, I think is a little dangerous, and to ignore it at the same time is not great either. So,
If you've been training for more than a couple of years in jiu-jitsu and you don't have a basic handle on the self-defense thing, if you can't handle someone roughly your size or a little bit bigger, then I suggest to you that you're doing something fundamentally wrong.
For sure. And my overarching view on it is what matters most is aliveness.
Right.
If you're rolling,
Define aliveness for our listeners.
Thank you.
Our listeners,
yeah.
Here. I 100% agree.
What separates Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu from Japanese Jiu-Jitsu? There are a lot of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu techniques in Japanese Jiu-Jitsu, but from what I've seen, for the most part, the person will come at you like this and you'll defend with this technique.
Technique number one, defense number
exactly.
one.
Exactly. But it's not, they'll have a lot of the same throws as Judo. But why is Judo so much more effective? Because of Randori. Because of the sparring. So aliveness for me is the live sparring where someone's actually trying to resist you. If you're rolling with a resisting opponent, I think automatically you are 100 times more prepared for a self-defense situation than someone who knows all sorts of techniques but never works them against a resisting opponent. So for me, it's almost insignificant, the discussion. At the same time, to not know how to defend against a headlock, should you ever end up there, it's just a really crappy situation to be in, and is to not be able to get out. I don't know of people who are high level jiu-jitsu people who have been in those situations, but you always hear the Gracie brothers talking about how they got an email from a purple belt who is a sport competitor but just got headlocked. And I've never actually met any of those people, but I would hate to be in that situation. And so for me, I feel lucky that I do have a background in the self-defense side of jiu-jitsu. It's something I do want my students to have, because I have had some have to use it. But I'd rather focus on using the art to develop ourselves as people.
Well, here's another point of view. I'm not saying that if you get in a street fight, you should pull upside down inverted guard. I'm not saying that. But, a lot of this, quote, modern stuff, like spider guard, say, tell you what, if you're wearing, okay, yes, you can't wear it if you're all greased up on the beach wearing a Speedo. Like, spider guard may not be your go-to plan.
Barambolo with the Speedos.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, it's an ugly vision. that can only go badly.
Yeah.
But, if you're dealing in a place where it's either rainy or cold for half the year, like, two-thirds of Canada and the United States, people are going to be wearing jackets.
Sure.
So you put somebody in a jacket, you put somebody in a raincoat, put somebody in a parka, you put them in spider guard, they are not punching you.
Sure.
They're also going to be swept in about 3 seconds if you have the slightest idea of what you're doing.
Yeah, I mean, the people who kind of critique jiu-jitsu for, or even sport jiu-jitsu for not preparing you for self-defense, they may be splitting hairs because, again, for me, it just goes, can you roll? You know, in any fight, doesn't matter if you're like old school Hicks and Gracie, like, or modern, you know, Marcelo or Mendez brothers, you're going to get hit. Fighting is going to cost you. You're going to get hurt. Can you minimize it? Can you use, you know, if there someone does have a jacket, yeah, totally, you can use it to immobilize them. But if that doesn't, like, if that doesn't work, you have other options. It's that being able to respond to a dynamic, ever-changing situation with an aggressive opponent that matters most.
Who's trying to do something to you while you're not trying to let them have do it to you.
Exactly. And so to that point, I might argue that might be an argument for competition.
Right.
Because you can't really replicate the intensity of competition in training. You know, every student I have that jumps into competition for the first time, it's like, whoa, that was so intense. Yeah. And
there's the gigantic adrenaline dump.
Yeah, exactly.
And dealing with that kind
the
of
emotions and the unknown environment, you know. So I think it's jiu-jitsu is an expression of you. If you're someone who feels that the beauty of jiu-jitsu is in the self-defense stuff, great, go teach that, and you will attract people who are attracted to that. If you think the beauty of jiu-jitsu is in the sport and the technicality or the how technical it is, great, go teach that, and you'll attract people who are attracted to that. And that's, for me, it's, you know, jiu-jitsu for me is a way to learn about yourself and to learn about life and connect with other people. And so I've been lucky to attract people who for whom that resonates. And that doesn't preclude competing or learning self-defense. It kind of includes it all, but with a different purpose. So for me, it's, you know, people get on these funny internet arguments about what's the best. I know, man, keep an open mind. Like, everyone, there's value in every perspective. To say that there's no value in sport is nonsense. To say there's no value in self-defense, I think is nonsense. And it's, for me, it's about learning from everyone. You know, the same way you can learn from a white belt on the mat, you can learn from someone who has a totally, that's why I don't badmouth other martial arts, because I personally feel jiu-jitsu should be the first martial art you learn, because we know it works, and if all else fails, use that. But I think there's probably a lot of value in other martial arts that people like myself who've just focused on one art may probably miss out on. So, you know, once I'm done competing, I would love to explore other martial arts and learn about the different aspects of what the body can do.
Your comment there about the self-defense benefits of competition got me. I don't think I've ever told this story before. The last street fight that I was almost in, I was walking down the street with Eric Paulsen and Loki Jorgensen. Obviously Eric Paulsen is one of Brock Lesnar's trainer, was a shooto light heavyweight champion in Japan for years, super well-respected, super tough guy. Loki Jorgensen, super high-level Filipino martial artist, and we're talking like full contact stick fighting, years and years and years of stick and knife training, and also a really tough guy. And the three of us are walking from the restaurant to the car, down a dark street. In a nice part of town, we hear this screaming across the street. And we look over and there's two groups of people. It was like three people and four people, and they're about to come to blows. And so it's none of our business, but we stop and watch. And then we realize the screaming is a woman, an older woman. She's yelling, "Leave my son alone! Leave my children alone!" So we realize it was an old woman and her two children being assaulted by three or four hoodlums. So that changes everything. The three of us, we start heading across the street. And very quickly, I mean, they're cowards, right? They're picking on an old woman, well, not an old woman, a middle-aged woman and her two children. They pretty much scatter as soon as they see three relatively big guys coming. But the adrenaline dump, I mean, I couldn't think of two guys who'd be better to be with in a situation like that. And we were bigger, and we were stronger, we're all highly trained, and so all the advantages are in our favor. And still, even there, the adrenaline dump, mm-hmm. it can really only be compared to, you know, in normal life, when you're not, you know, throwing yourself into stupid situations like that, or potentially dangerous situations like that for a good reason, is competition, because you get that, you know, totally. Every nerve opens up, or you get soaked in neurochemicals anyway.
Yeah.
And
that, you know, when I was still in the corporate world, people would ask, like, man, how are you so calm? And I would say, listen, when you've had someone who's trained to put people to sleep and break their arms, try to put you to sleep and break your arms for real.
Yeah.
Suddenly your boss being upset with you is not so stressful, right? It, like, your threshold goes to here so that everything that irritates you doesn't even approach that. And for me, there is a ton of value in competition. And I kind of struggle with that because I never want to push anyone to compete at the same time, you know, so I don't push any of my students. At the same time, I do believe it's incredibly valuable as a life experience. And that for me is kind of the whole value of all aspects of training and competing. You know, so we have a bunch of guys who are aiming for, and I think will become, world champions. And, you know, that in and of itself is cool. But the real value for me in that is what that's going to do for their self-awareness and their self-confidence and their ability to, their belief in self and their realization of what they're capable of. For me, that's the real, you know, it all goes back to what you can take off the mat. So
it's okay. Well, I think we're going to wrap this conversation up, Elliot. But if people want to get in touch with you or train with you, how do they do it? Go pimp your stuff.
All right. Well, we have an awesome school, as we talked about, downtown Toronto, down at Yonge and Wellesley. Super central. You can get there from either transit line. The website is openmat.ca, openmat.ca. Shoot us an email at classes@openmat.ca or give us a call at 647-269-8466. The exact address is 593 Yonge Street, so right on Yonge Street. It's, again, it's a beautiful spot. We'd love to have you come by, check it out. We've got incredible instructors, students. We also offer Muay Thai and an awesome fitness program. We have pretty incredible washrooms as well, which for the working crowd definitely matters.
Train and then go back to work.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so whether you're brand new or you've been training for a long time, you know, we've got a great crew and we'd love to have you, so come on by.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Elliot. Take care and best of luck with your competition at the end of the month.
Thank you.